Welcome to another episode of Heavy Muscle Radio. I'm Dave Palumbo, and I'm joined, as always, by the technician, Chris Aceto, on this April 17th, 2017 afternoon. And, Chris, we are getting deeper into the bodybuilding season, and the drama among, I guess you could say, among athletes slash press has gotten to a, I guess you could say, to a crescendo, so to speak.
Well, Dave, all we need to calm our nerves, we just need to play a clip of Cedric's victory speech where he said, "Social media made this shit. Social media made this shit even worse." Right?
Yeah, yeah, he did say that. He also said, "Push forward to find peace." That was Lee Thompson's quote of Cedric Piccolo.
Oh, did he say that? Who said that? That was Lee, Cedric. So that was
Lee Thompson. Who, for those of you who haven't followed the Lee Thompson saga, Lee Thompson was one of the top judges, I guess, and he ran the District of Texas, NPC District, that is. And he would judge all the pro shows, and they would basically send them all around the world because no one wanted to fly, you know, to China and South Africa. And Lee loved to fly and do stuff like that, and he was good at it. So they would send him to head judge all these shows, and invariably, you know, specifically that you and I know the Arnold Brazil. I forget what year that was. Was it 15, 14?
Catastrophic.
Where Cedric and you were in traffic in a car heading towards the competitors' meeting, and Shawn Ray basically informed Lee Thompson that Cedric was late or something like that, and Lee Thompson decided that he was going to disqualify him, even though they were, you know, 6,000 miles away from home, and Cedric couldn't do the show. Actually, he could have done the show because I know you had called Steve Weinberger and Steve had called Jim Mannion, and they both said put him in the show, it's fine, and I guess Cedric decided he wasn't going to do the show because he didn't want to, like, you know, Cedric's a guy who's in the army and he listens to orders, and Lee Thompson gave him an order and he's like, I'm not going to, you know, override.
No. Cedric knew that vindictive guy would get there and the judge and sit there in the first call out, right?
Yeah.
And say, wait a minute, I kicked him out and this mother effer is back in.
Right.
I'm just going to place him like eighth.
Yeah.
That's why.
That's true. Yeah.
That's why.
So Cedric would have rather sat out the show. I understand. Makes sense.
So, you know, the point is, I mean, you know, he understood. One thing you can say about Cedric McMillan, he knows people.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Human nature. He doesn't know his own human nature, but he knows everyone else's. That's for sure. Yeah.
That's okay. That's okay. Sometimes the best, you know, that's the most difficult thing in the world is to figure out your own, but it's easy to figure out others.
Right.
And at that show, he was kicked out of the show. And not only was he kicked out of the show, but he showed up at the meeting late, at the very tail end of it. And
something that happens all the time, by the way. Yeah, it's not uncommon for guys not even to show up. In other words, if he hadn't shown up, probably they wouldn't have even realized that he wasn't there, and he probably wouldn't have got disqualified. Probably the worst thing that he did was show up at the end, you know?
There was the cheerleaders of Shawn Ray cheering on Lee Thompson, getting them all wet, that Cedric had missed FIBO. I was at FIBO. Cedric won it.
Right.
It was Ed Nunn who was late for the meeting. So maybe Sean or Lee or both can't figure out, you know, Sean, that Cedric is not Ed, or Ed does not look like Cedric. But
Ed does look like Ronnie Coleman, though. I will give him that much. I could definitely confuse those two guys.
Whatever the case, I was standing right there.
Right.
When Lee came fuming and physically running and throwing his chest out like Yosemite Sam at Cedric.
Yeah.
And I know my reaction, what it would be. And I just stood back and thought, let's see how Cedric handles this. Mm-hmm. Cedric did not raise his voice. Cedric did not show anger. Cedric did not try to demean anyone. He said, Lee, I'm late. I have a great reason for being late. And Lee would have nothing of it. He didn't want to hear it, which I thought, you know, in any dispute, the first thing you do is you listen to both sides of the story. You always listen to both sides of the story. Otherwise, you're setting yourself up for failure. And that's what Lee did. He did not listen at all. He did say, make the comment, the dig, to other people when I was there, that Cedric, how is this guy in the military when he can't even be on time for an athletes meeting? If that's not a personal dig, still,
yeah,
without knowing, why is this guy late?
Yeah, exactly. Exactly. I mean, if anyone has ever sat in Rio de Janeiro traffic during rush hour, you'll know that it's there's nothing you can do. You basically, it's worse than New York traffic, you know. So, let's flash forward. Unless you want to add more to that.
No, I mean, there is more to it, because you know what? What is burned in my mind from that weekend is after that, I text Lee, and I said, Lee, it was not, just to give you some context, you did not listen. You did not hear Cedric out on why he was late. I know why he was late, Dave. I know exactly why.
You were with him.
No, I was not with him. I was already at the Probiotica venue. I was at the venue with Probiotica. Cedric, me and Cedric stayed. Mm-hmm. You had to go.
We have this, nice, like, I don't know if you hear this noise. There's like this like little bell going off. I don't know what the hell it is, but it's driving me crazy. I think it's coming from Skype. But
where we stayed was like a nice residential high-end neighborhood, mm-hmm, not too far from the venue, right, like 7 miles. The one way out of the neighborhood is through a tunnel, through a mountain.
Wow.
And when Cedric got ready to leave well in advance.
When you say well in advance, how?
2 hours in advance.
2 hours, okay.
15 minutes, 15-minute car ride.
Okay.
There was an accident inside the tunnel.
Oh, boy.
So regardless if there was an accident, regardless if he was just simply late, fell asleep, nobody listened to his story.
Right.
Why are you late, Cedric? So after the fact that Cedric was kicked out without anyone listening to his side of the story.
Right.
After that, I had texted Lee Thompson and said, you know, you probably should have, you know, given kind of like a quote hearing to Cedric to see why he was late, because I'm under the impression now, I'm hearing that you thought he was late in FIBO. And I'm telling you, he was absolutely not late at FIBO. The reason I know that is that Joe Eda had recently died.
Mm-hmm.
Lee gave kind of a speech at the athletes meeting, which I thought was odd, in honor of Joe Eda.
Mm-hmm.
I knew Joe Eda fairly well, and I didn't know that Lee knew him. Maybe he did, maybe he didn't, but he gave a speech and implied that they were, like, close.
Right.
So I remember that because I remember distinctly what I was thinking about, the oddness of the speech. And then the other oddness is, I don't like this. This is just not me. Can we all hold hands? And I'm standing next to, guess who? Not Edna and Cedric. And Cedric said something like, something about a joke about holding hands with me.
Yeah. Did he hump
don't
you?
Don't get too close to me, white boy.
Did he try to hump you?
So that's how I know Cedric was at that FIBO meeting.
Right.
So
he actually made the meeting is what you're saying. He just got FIBO, late.
Yes. Okay. And so what is burned in my brain from that text messaging was me giving Lee the context. I was at the FIBO meeting. Cedric was right there with me. You didn't listen to why Cedric was late, and you are giving it the context of this is a problem, two meetings in a row, which he's been late. And which
you were talking about the FIBO meeting he gave the speech at. Okay.
Yeah. Yes. Okay. Yes.
I confused
Lee Thompson. And Lee said, and I quote, Cedric needs to be taught a lesson. Sounds like something out of an Alex Haley book.
Exactly. Yeah, it's
that's what bothered me.
Yeah. Well, you know, it was very disrespectful. I mean, any athlete that, I mean, Lee, I don't know if Lee's ever competed or not, but I mean, any athlete that has put his soul on the line for this, dieted, suffered, you know, did whatever they had to do to get to the point where they could be competing for a top IFBB pro title, you know, in another country, nonetheless. To take that away from someone because of something so petty just shows the character of the person. Now, supposedly Lee Thompson now is like, ever since he left the IFBB and started his own whatever organization now, and he's like supposedly like reborn, and he's trying to say how, you know, he's a different person now, and so he tried to post this post that he waited in line to see Cedric and Phoebo this year, and that, you know, he was so happy, and he was telling him how proud he was of him and the speech that he made, and he was making it seem like, you know, everything was so great. The bottom line would have been, if Lee would have been a real man of character, he would have gone up to Cedric and said, "Hey, you know what, Cedric? I was this terrible person before. I fucked up. I fucked you. You know, and he would have thrown himself on Cedric's mercy to get, you know, forgiveness. And I'm sure Cedric would have forgiven him, because that's just the way Cedric is. But he didn't do that. And that's not what he wrote on Facebook. He made it seem like they're best friends, like that, oh, it was such a great reunion. I just saw, you know, Cedric. I told him how proud I was of him and what he did at the Arnold with that speech. And
well, you know what?
I don't believe it.
Well, you know what, Dave? You know what? Maybe he is proud. Maybe he has genuine pride. Maybe he has. I'll give him the benefit of the doubt.
You think he thinks he's responsible for that, for teaching Cedric a lesson?
No, maybe he has genuine pride that a bodybuilder went up on stage and gave this, it's the Barack Obama speech of, yeah, you know, 1990, whatever, the 2000, when Barack Obama gave that convention speech.
Yeah.
But if he's proud of Cedric, he should, I would expect, have a shame of what he did to Cedric. Mm.
And I would have liked to have seen him, you know, ask for forgiveness.
Well, I mean, if you have no shame, then you can't ask for forgiveness.
I guess. Yeah, that's...
Right? Because if you have no shame, then you're completely oblivious to the pain that you are causing people.
You're right. You're right.
You know
now,
what?
Now, the interesting thing was...
If Phil Heath missed the athletes meeting for some reason...
Do you think they would disqualify him?
No.
The Olympia?
No. But the point would be, I would love him to miss the Olympia. Like, you know, this year I'm not doing it. Yeah. That would be nice.
Right.
But if he had, you know, something we find out at the athletes meeting, you know, say, he can't be here. I'd be like, and one, nobody would be kicking him out. But two, if they even contemplated it, I'd be like, how can you have a Mr. Olympia contest without the number one guy in the show? And Cedric was the number one guy going into that show.
Easily. I think that would have been a walkthrough for him, that show. I mean, we don't know, obviously, but I mean, no one was great. What was the year Brandon, the Steve Kuklo one?
No, it was Brandon
Carter.
The whole lineup was off.
Oh, right. But I mean, Brandon was good, but he wasn't great. He wasn't like he was, you know, right, just recently.
Correct. But the irony of the conflation of, you know, the idea that you can just go make malice and mischief and then like, oh, nothing happened. So proud of you, bro.
Yeah.
And there's a reason. And you know what? What comes around goes around. You know, he's not traveling around the earth anymore officiating and judging shows. He's just, you know, trying to pretend that he's going to rival the Mr. Olympia with the league that is no longer a league.
Yeah. Well, I think this is also important. Now, you don't ever post on Facebook. You're an Instagram guy. And I see, I noticed that you've posted in response to Lee's post that I just kind of talked about, where he was making it seem like him and Cedric are great friends and he waited in line to talk to him. And you even said, I never come to Facebook, and I believe this is probably your third or fourth post ever. And you said, I cringe reading this knowing it was Lee Thompson who kicked Cedric out of Arnold, Brazil a few years back for showing up at the very tail end of the competitors meeting. I was standing there with Cedric when Cedric very politely attempted to speak with Lee Thompson to explain his reason for being late. Lee would have nothing of it. While he heard Cedric loud and clear, give his genuine acceptance speech, he could not give Cedric 3 minutes to try to explain why he was late for that meeting. Lee acted without counsel, without listening, took matters into his own hands, and removed Cedric from the competitors' list. And you know it shows what a better person Cedric McMillan is, because he forgives people who do him seriously wrong. And I thought that was a very good post. And I actually see that Lee Thompson responded. And he basically said, thank you, Chris. I did wrong for the federation I served. And for that, I'm sorry. I'm grateful for forgiveness and restoration. But what he's basically saying...
Read that again.
He said, Chris, I did wrong for the federation I served. And for that, I am sorry. I'm grateful for forgiveness and restoration.
You didn't do wrong for the federation. You did wrong to the result of your wrongness,
He acted on his own accord, though. He's acting like he was acting from orders.
There was only one person. The federation was not wrong.
No one was there. He was he acted as the federation. He didn't call up Jim Mannion and say
Cedric was wrong. Period.
He's trying to put the blame for the decision he made on the IFBB.
The issue was and is to this day that decision was made only by Lee Thompson.
Exactly.
Decision was not made by Arnold. That decision was not made by Raphael. That decision was not made by Jim Mannion. That decision was not made by Steve Weinberger. They were all shocked and oblivious to that decision. And that decision did not affect anyone but Cedric.
Yep. And not only, you want to know how it affected him? He lost $35,000 first prize money, and Blackman used that as an excuse to cancel his
Blackman's
contract.
Blackman had his fingers in that bullshit all the time. Don't do the show. It's controversial. Put him on the cover. That's when I knew the guy was a Looney Tune. That's another quote. He told me in a text. Just keep him out of the show. Keep him out of the show. It's controversial. It's good for his publicity and MD. These fucking people are nuts.
And then he fires him and uses the reason for firing Cedric in the middle of his contract that he was probably paying him a lot of money for, that he didn't do the Arnold Brazil after he told you to sit out the show.
People don't want to hear controversial stuff. I know I spoke to people this week. You know what? This is just factual. The people with the egg on their face here is Lee, number one. Second, I forget because I didn't forget. Is Steve Blackman's nonsense. Keep him out of the show. It's controversial. It's good for his career. I remember saying, quote back to Steve, are you fucking crazy?
Yeah.
Keep the guy whose passion is to compete in bodybuilding shows, keep him out of the show. It's good for his career. That means people who are trying to influence you like Steve Blackman have no common sense, dude. Yeah. None.
These insights that people
think of, just flip it around, dude. Just flip it around for anyone, not Steve Blackman.
They're such troublemakers, those guys.
Ty, stay out of the show. Phil, stay out of the show. Dexter, stay out of the show. It's good. Yeah. It's controversial and good publicity. Think how if Kai went to someone and said, well, so-and-so told me to stay out of the show, that, you know, it was it's good. They'd say, who told you?
Only a person who's never competed would say that, because they would have no clue as to what sacrifices were made to get there.
No, sorry, Dave. Only a person who has only his and not your best interest in mind.
Yeah, that's true. But also,
even people who are selfish,
but if they've competed and gone through the process, I think they would even have more sympathy for a competitor.
I felt I was like in a crazy house that weekend. Yeah. I hear, we got to teach him a lesson.
You know who used to do that? Carl Campagna was before Steve Weinberger was the chairman of New York State. Carl Campagna ran the NPC. And if you showed up late for competitors' meetings or missed, registering, they wouldn't let you in the show. It didn't matter if you hit traffic. He was a real hardcore Italian guy who was like, this is the rules. If you don't play by the rules, you don't play. And, you would be petrified backstage. And I don't know why Lee Thompson did that. And I hope he's a different person now. I just think he was just basically trying to butter up to Cedric. And in the post that he put up, if he would have asked for his apology and for his, you know, and told us, hey, you know, look, I'm a different person. I feel bad for what I did to him. But he didn't. He put the brunt of it on the IFBB and said, like, they were the ones who did it. And he was just basically just following orders, you know, just like the Nazi guys that were throwing the fucking Jews into the oven said, oh, we were just following orders from Hitler, you know. And but that wasn't the truth, because no one gave him that order. No one gave him. That was his own order. And I think that that's a very important clarification. Now, let's move on to other arguments and drama.
End the show there.
End the show there, yeah. That should have been an Iron Rant, right? Or Iron Rage. So, as you know, we talked about it last week. When I, at FIBO, yep. I had my own drama with the Flex Wheeler in the lobby. And I told the story last week. Mm-hmm. And about that Flex was upset with me, that we had held an Iron Debate show. And he wasn't upset with what I said, but he was upset that I allowed Valentino and Boston Lloyd to poke fun at him in some capacity. Matter of fact, I have to go rewatch it, because I think it was really done tongue in cheek. But he took offense to it, and he wouldn't shake my hand, that was fine. But then he was trying to escalate it, like, you know, to a physical confrontation, like if I didn't walk out of his face. And yeah, he didn't raise his voice, but you know, his tone got nasty with me. And I basically felt that I needed to tell everyone what happened, because I thought it was kind of odd. Now, I used the term, I said, and once again, I used it tongue in cheek. I said, maybe he was in a roid rage, you know, just because I thought it was a funny thing to say, but because I've never, you know, I thought Flex and I were friends, and he knows I didn't say anything bad. I didn't say anything bad about him. So I was taken aback by it, you know, and I was upset, because I actually like Flex. He's one of the few people in this industry. You know, I know some people don't like him, but I like him. I think he's a breath of fresh air. He's not afraid to say his opinion about things. He has good insights into bodybuilding. In other words, when I used to do analysis with him we both worked for MD, he had good insights, and we got along really well. And that's why when people would say to me, oh, Flex is this, I don't like him, I said, well, you don't know Flex the way I do. So when for me to, you know, go up to him in a lobby in a foreign country and to try to shake his hand, and for him to basically say, you know, I don't want to shake your hand, that was upsetting to me, you know, really, because like I said, not only was he a guy I looked up to when I was competing, but he was also a person I got to know personally and was friends with. So that was bothersome to me. And so I know Bob Cicherillo and David Bay have their own little last rep show or something like that they do on YouTube. And I guess they were discussing it, because Bob was there. You know, Bob was sitting in the lobby. He saw the whole thing. Bob's like, you know, Dave said we looked, Branch and I looked a little uneasy. I said, well, yeah, of course you looked uneasy, because he, you know, and he's like, well, I thought that, you know, Flex was going to beat Dave's ass, you know. Well, yeah, well, obviously you were uneasy. You know, it was an uncomfortable situation, because I know all you guys, and whatever goes on, but I don't think that I disrespected Flex at all. You know, I know these guys felt like I should have just, I should have defended him to Valentino and Boston Lloyd. I should have stuck up for him and said, hey guys, let's not go there. But you know, look, it's an Iron Debate show. You don't censor debate. You know, some opinions are not going to be popular, and some will be. That's the nature of the show. If I censor the show, then it's not Iron Debate anymore. It's just another show, you know?
You know, Greg Valentino, people know
his shtick.
Greg's shtick. It's humorous, it's funny, it's over the top. And what I remember about the show is I laughed my ass off when he compared Flex to Derek Jeter. It'd be like Flex coming back to classic.
Right.
Would be like Derek Jeter playing softball in the like police athletic league and calling you up and saying, I just hit 4 home runs today. Right. You know, the way he delivered it, it was funny.
Yeah, it wasn't meant as a negative.
It was meant to be. Yeah. It's not. It's meant to be satire.
Right.
It's not meant to be a real world description that his level of development will be at that of like a newbie or something into bodybuilding.
Well, they're upset that Cicherillo's upset that I said that Flex had roid rage, and that I didn't say he had. I said that I made a tongue in cheek joke out of a very uncomfortable situation. I would put anyone else in my situation, and I don't even know how I would come out of it. I mean, my dad always said to me, in any situation, you know, you could always find humor in it. And that's what I look for. I look for humor.
You know what they probably didn't discuss on the show? Let me guess.
What?
Their own opinions of Flex.
Right. They didn't give any opinions. They didn't give no
their opinions. Own opinions of Flex doing the classic or not doing the classic. Right. Did they voice their own opinions? And I would say, unlike some people, right, they both are, quote, experts. I mean, how many shows have they been to and critiqued? Cicherillo was a great bodybuilder, especially early in his career when he was like a 20-year-old phenom. So, I mean, what they say in terms of evaluating physiques holds some weight.
Sure.
You or I may differ from that at a bodybuilding contest.
Right.
But did they weigh in on if they thought it was, in their own personal opinion, good decision, bad decision? Do they think he's going to look absolutely, you know, great or pretty good or not so good?
Right.
I bet they didn't. Am I right?
No, they didn't say anything. Because everyone's afraid because they're friends with him. They're afraid to comment, and that's where it goes back to. You know, Bob said that maybe there's something wrong with me because I called Flex. You know, I said that Flex had roid rage or that Peter McGuff was drunk. And you know what? The truth is, these guys who want to be superstars wouldn't last 1 week in Hollywood with TMZ and all the other stuff that goes on. I mean, everyone wants entertainment from this sport. They want our sport to be less boring, have mainstream appeal. But most of the stars that we have in our sport are so insecure that they can't laugh at themselves. So how could we ever have mainstream appeal? How could we ever be accepted by the general public when we can't even take a single funny joke about ourselves? You know, it goes back to also, did I make Shawn Ray rudely steal Ashkenani away from me at that interview at the Arnold backstage? No. Did I tell Peter McGuff to charge me and grab my microphone? No. Did I attack Flex Wheeler? No, he threatened me because he was upset that two of the top social media guys in our business, guys who work for his website, Generation Iron, were poking fun at me.
What do you mean they work for his website? Who?
Well, he is the executive vice president now of Generation Iron, the Generation Iron YouTube channel and website. So Valentino is and Boston Lloyd are paid employees. They get paid to do videos for that website.
Maybe they should be fired.
Yeah, maybe. Maybe they should. Maybe their videos should be taken down, but I don't think they'll do that because they got a ton of hits, more hits than anything else on their site. So, you know, so they're upset. He threatened me because of these two guys. And the funny thing was they were only poking fun of him with good intentions. They were not like, we hate Flex Wheeler. We want to just put him down. So that's where I find it a little hypocritical. I don't know how I could be wrong about bringing this to light, you know, but if Bob thinks that I'm there's something wrong with me because I'm exposing this, then I guess, yeah, I'm guilty as charged, you know. What this conversation amounts to is a lot of people in our sport, I should say a lot of interest in our sport by the fans this provides because people like people stuff. You know, why do you think reality TV is so popular, Chris? People like to like real. That's why this stuff that we're talking about that I think is a complete waste of time, this will probably be one of our best radio shows because people like people stuff. It's drama.
Yeah, well, they like it versus let me call up Chad and find out how many grams of protein Flex is on and how many carbs.
Yeah.
I think it's interesting, but really not.
People just have to lighten up. If the industry names want to paint me as purposely creating drama, yeah, then I'm guilty as charged. But Peter McGuff at 70 years old charging me backstage at the Arnold Classic is pretty damn funny. Wouldn't you say, Chris?
Well, it's, you know,
I would have said I was drunk if I was him because otherwise what other explanation is? And I don't know if he was drunk. And you know what the truth is? I'm really sorry I kind of said that. Because he took it, obviously he must have taken it personally. It wasn't meant personally. It was meant as funny because you're 70 years old and you charged me backstage and you didn't even know why. I mean, that's funny. There's nothing wrong with that. You could laugh at yourself. All right, you overreacted, whatever. It's funny, you know, and that's people just have to lighten up. You know, Flex Wheeler, Chris, physically threatening me in Germany was an interesting story that people loved hearing about. Did Flex intend it to be that way? No, he was trying to intimidate me. You know, but like I said, my dad taught me a very important coping mechanism in life, And you guys, and these other guys ought to try it. You know, always find humor in what you do. You know,
are you shitting me? Your father's high as a kite all day. That's his couple back.
You always find humor in every situation, no matter how grim or depressing it may be. You know, when I tore my quad, Chris, in New Delhi, India, in a gym there, I was pretty damn upset, as you can imagine. I'm in India, and I tore my quad. I didn't know what I tore. I thought my knee exploded. But the broken down looking, this little carriage they had to put me in, that looked like it was from the Middle Ages. It was being pulled by some like 90-year-old guy. I had to get in there because I couldn't walk back to the hotel. That was fucking pretty damn funny. I was laughing. Here I am with a torn quad in another country, not knowing what the fuck is going to happen. And I'm laughing at this predicament that I'm in. And so, you know, everyone's got to stop taking themselves so goddamn seriously and just laugh at yourself once in a while. It's all right. There's nothing wrong. We're human. We all do silly, crazy things. God knows I do more than anyone probably.
Yeah, well, you know, it'd be nice for you to sit. You know what? Great interview. Dave interviews Flex Wheeler. Because you've had conversations with him on his comeback, right? Private conversations.
Yeah.
But you know, there's not. I don't know. Maybe there is out there. I haven't seen it. An in-depth, you know, one-on-one with Flex. Because, you know, people want to know what he has to say. That's for sure. People want to hear his mindset, you know, why he's coming back, why now, what his focus is going to be, you know, what are they going to be the challenges compared to, you know, when he was competing years ago, you know, did Kevin Lavrone have any influence, you know, his comeback, is he worried that Shawn Ray's going to torpedo him and say it's the worst decision he ever made? And like I said, on the debate show, I'm already on the record. I don't want to see Flex Wheeler come back. I support, you know, and that is because of this. You know, I'm 50. A lot of people in the sport, I forget, because I'm around them, right? They're 32, 28, 25. 20, right. Cody Montgomery is like 14. Reagan Grimes is like 18.
Yeah.
I mean, they don't even know, you know, other than looking at pictures, who Dorian and Flex or what Lavrone or even Shawn Ray looked like in their prime. And I know at his absolute best, Flex Wheeler, 92, 93, and include 98, but 92, 93, he was, that body is not coming on the planet ever again. For whatever reason, I don't know. I don't know if it's genetics, if it's, you know, whatever the reason, we are not going to see that zany type of physique ever again. And that's how I like to remember Flex Wheeler. That's what's burned into my brain, other than the quotes from Lee Thompson. You know, the greatness of Flex Wheeler. And yeah, sure, he might be tremendous this year at the Olympia. You know, he may actually be unbelievable. But, you know, as a purist, I think back to, I'll do this. I liked him better when he was in 92, 93. Well, and that's what I have to say on that topic.
Well, you know what the truth is? The truth is, and I hate to say this, but you might not like Flex Wheeler coming back, but it's probably the most important story of the Mr. Olympia competition that's going to take place in September. It's the most. It's doing what Lavrone did last year. It's getting people excited because now people think, well, you know, he's not doing bodybuilding, he's doing classic physique, he might have a chance to win this thing because, you know, he doesn't have to be bigger than everyone else, you know? And, you know, it's the feel-good story of the Olympia. It's eclipsed the fact that Phil is going for win number 7, which only Arnold Schwarzenegger has done, and Lee Haney and Ronnie have done 8, obviously. But it's eclipsed that story, and really it shouldn't, because the truth of the matter is that the Mr. Olympia competition itself, Phil Heath, Sean Roden, Big Ramy, you know, that to me, this might be one of the best Olympias we ever had. And people don't even realize it because the competitors who are in this show in that top 5 have matured physique-wise so much so over the last couple of years that I guess you could say quality-wise and talent-wise, it may be one of the deepest ever. Let's not forget Dexter Jackson, who took the whole year off, who's gunning to try to win his second Mr. Olympia at age, whatever, 48 he is. So, I mean, this Olympia is exciting. People should be excited about it. They should want to go. Flex Wheeler's kind of a sideshow, you know, in the classic physique. But that, I mean, obviously that's going to add a huge, also bump in excitement for people. But the Mr. Olympia itself, I mean, is knock your socks off fantastic this year. I think it's going to be one of the best ones ever. And I think it's a sleeper because a lot of people, they don't hear as much controversy in the open event because there's no Kai Greene or there's Dennis Wolf is not competing. But I got news for you. You know, it's going to be a close show. We're going to see a huge big Rami in there. We're going to see a Dexter Jackson who wants to knock off Phil. Phil coming back with a vengeance after last year's great showing. This is going to be a top-level Olympia.
Well, I'm glad that Lee Thompson's not going to be there as the head judge because can you imagine
And who did I think? Cedric McMillan.
Can you imagine Flex is late for the bus, and so the whole world's waiting for him to walk out on stage, but he can't compete.
No, but think about it. I mistakenly forgot to mention Cedric McMillan in that mix because now, as the Arnold Classic champion, I don't want to say the word momentum. He doesn't believe in momentum, but he definitely has a physique that can stand next to these guys. And let's face it, Cedric, Phil, Dexter, Rami, who am I forgetting? Rodin, they all have completely different physiques.
Yeah.
It's like none of them look like each other, which makes it harder for the judges, but it also is more exciting because everyone brings something different to the table, and the fans and the press, we all seem to gravitate towards a certain look that we can relate to. So we all want to see different guys win. So to me, that's exciting. There's no, and Phil is always, Phil beats people, but he just beats them. So it's never a blowout like the Ronnie Coleman years or the Dorian Yates years where, he's going to win again, So it always is exciting. You never know who could win this show. And, to me, the interview of interviews, I would love to have, and I'll probably never get it because he's on the contract. I would love to interview Phil Heath and see what he's thinking because we have never heard. The only time we hear from Phil Heath is his acceptance speech after he wins the Olympia.
Well, we hear snippets from Phil,
right?
And I think we haven't heard. You know what I would like to hear from Phil actually, and he probably doesn't listen to the show. Remy listens to every show, so hello Remy. So does Jay Cutler. Hi Jay. Because they've told me that, but Phil probably doesn't. But I would like to hear an interview with you and hear Phil explain why nobody's going to beat him, why he's number one, why he can't be beat. And I don't mean that, and he might come across as either extremely arrogant, but he hasn't been beat. So it's like his right to come across any way he wants to come across. Or, in an in-depth interview, other than snippets of something he may have said here or there, mm-hmm. he may come across as someone that, just knows his position, is extremely confident, but not arrogant. And I think you need to, that type of interview, that type of setting where it's an extended 45 minutes versus, you get to where at the press conference, people just want to push his buttons. That's the goal. Trying to push Phil's buttons.
Right.
I can predict it this year. Rami's going to be like 390 and, you're going to hear Rami's 390 and how are you going to deal with that, Phil? And Phil's going to say, I already beat him every time he's been here. But no, he's 390 and the Camel crew said he's at his best. And then they're going to go to, Dexter took the whole year off. How are you going to – they just want to push Phil's buttons.
Right.
And it's – that's not the environment for – it's not a conversational environment where Phil can say, listen, this is why – nobody's beating me.
Right. I also would love to know what Phil thinks, because Phil has to sit back, and I will say one thing for him. He's really good. He doesn't post on social media, anything negative. He doesn't argue with people on that, not usually at least. And, everyone's going to be a critic of Mr. Olympia because, everyone wants to knock him off. Let's figure out what's wrong with him. So Phil is, keeps his head together pretty well. He channels his energy into the gym. And, he tries to bring a better look every year. And that's in and of itself, people don't realize, people think it's easy once you win. Oh, now you're Mr. Olympia. No, it's pressure because every year there's someone wanting to knock you off. And you got to be worried about that. And you got to train harder so that they can't. And, there's always the naysayers in the press saying, oh, Phil could be beat this year. And we've said it before. So, you got to deal with that. That's a hard mental, pill to swallow. And I'd like to know where he got this strong mindset from, because you can't win six Olympias without having a strong mindset.
The the problem with being Phil Heath is if he comes in the exact same as last year, that's enough to win. But people say, can't make any improvements, man. A whole year off and he can't make any improvements.
But he doesn't, he doesn't need to make any improvements.
Which is ridiculous.
Yeah.
Or if he comes in looking the exact same and he's got a little water in the midsection, let's say, people say, oh, midsection just destroyed his look. Destroyed. I had him eight. A lot of people had him eight.
You're right. So no, they always got to judge you against your best. You know, yeah.
Half of the comments are ridiculous, which is all the more reason for, and it's, of course, it's not going to happen where Dave Palumbo sits down with Phil Heath and, you know, puts him on the couch so that Phil can do some bragging, but in context.
Well, I think the Mr. Olympia is going to be a terrific competition this year. I think the 212 Olympia with Flex Lewis just being so dominant, can he be beaten? I mean, that's a, you know, that's an interesting story right there. I mean, the figure lineup, I mean, Latoya Watts losing at the Arnold to Candace Lewis. What's going to happen at the Olympia? I mean, Oksana Grishina, it's her last Miss Olympia ever. This is her last performance ever on an IFBB stage, so she says. So, I mean, these are all, you know, exciting sub-stories. I got to, you know, and I got to give credit where credit's due. While Robin Chang and I have had, you know, our little disputes in the past, you know, and he's, you know, whatever has happened with not getting press passes or whatever, you can't take away the fact the guy is an amazing promoter. I mean, he does a terrific job at the Olympia. People can criticize all they want, anything, but the truth of the matter is you try to put on a production of that magnitude and then talk to me. This guy makes it happen. I mean, that between the expo, which is always super, super packed and it's really set up really nicely, between the stage, I mean, the press conference, I mean, there's a lot of work that goes into that, and there's a huge staff behind that. And so to me, you know, that those guys, you know, Robin and his crew make that show enjoyable for you, me, the fans, okay, all the people coming and watching around the world. I mean, if it wasn't for them, the show would be crap, okay? And you don't want the Mr. Olympia show to be, you know, showcased in such a poor light. Now, supposedly this year, and I don't know the exact involvement of The Rock, but The Rock's production company is doing something this year with the Olympia, which obviously adds another layer of excitement because The Rock, you know, is a big Hollywood star now. I mean, I read an article, Chris, that The Rock may be the biggest Hollywood star right now of anyone.
Yeah, I saw that.
Is that crazy? I mean, when you think about it, where he came from a bodybuilding roots to wrestling to, I mean, that's an Arnold Schwarzenegger story if I've ever seen one, don't you think?
Yeah, it's a big story. Let me just comment once on the Robin Chang promotional value. You know what's the most the biggest snippet that represents the organizational skills of the Olympia is, I can't remember what time the pre-judging starts, but if it's like 7 p.m. on a Friday or whatever, inevitably bodybuilding shows are notoriously running late. You know what I mean? The 2 o'clock show at a pro show really starts at 2:40, and 2 o'clock show starts at 2:20. 2 o'clock shows, you know, at best 2:15. Every year, you know, people are like, where's the audience? You know, the audience is there. They're still getting into their seats. And if it starts at 8, literally, you hear Cicerillo's voice at like 7:59. And we're about to be 8 o'clock. First guy's on the stage. I'm like, God, they're starting already.
Yeah.
In other words, I'm thinking, why are they starting already? Well, they're starting on time. They always start on time.
Yeah, if I ran the show, we'd be starting an hour and a half late probably. We'd be there all night with my level of efficiency. I mean, you got to take your hat off to that whole crew that puts on that Olympia. But, you know, people always say to themselves, and I remember back in the 90s, the excitement level, people would be like, oh, you're going to the Olympia, you go to the Olympia. And back then it was just like bodybuilding. You know, there was no other divisions. And, can't wait to go to the Olympia. You know, that excitement should be there again, you know, because this is if you love the sport of bodybuilding and physique development in general, I mean, this is the pinnacle. I mean, if you're going to pick a show to get on an airplane and go watch, okay, and see in person and experience, it's the Mr. Olympia. Is the Arnold Classic a better expo and bigger? Yeah, because they have like 6 million sports there that day. But is the Olympia experience a better experience? Absolutely, because it's the best in the world. You don't see Phil Heath on the Arnold Classic stage anymore. You don't see, you know, all these top guys at their best vying to become named the best bodybuilder in the world. And that level of excitement with the whole Vegas backdrop there and all the excitement that goes along with that hoop and holler and the casinos and everything, it's super exciting experience. So like I said, we're far enough out now that if people are trying to plan, if you've never seen the Mr. Olympia in person, man, grab it now while you can, because who knows where it'll be. Maybe they'll move it to another country in a couple of years. You know, you don't know. They used to move it around all the time. I hear they're keeping it in Vegas, but that could change. So I'm telling you, if you haven't been there, it's a terrific experience. And Vegas is so much fun. It's so easy. The airport's right there. It's so easy to get around. To me, that's one of my favorite shows, and I would never want to miss it. I mean, if at some point in the future I do miss one, I hope, you know, it doesn't happen. But that to me is one of the shows. That and the Arnold, I just love those shows. But the Olympia excitement, when you and I sit there and do that play-by-play and we're like talking back and forth, what do you think about this? What do you think about that? I mean, you can't – the energy, you can't – it's palpable. You can feel it in
the
venue.
It's the only show where the bodybuilders – towards the end, like the last 2 days,
yeah,
get really big butterflies. You know what I mean?
It's the biggest stage on earth.
You can feel it. You feel it, and you see people's game faces, especially like the last 2 days. If you run into someone, you just see that they're not there. In other words, you see that they might be looking at you, but there's no way that they recognize who you are. I mean, you know what I mean? They're just
right.
Their mind is somewhere else.
Yeah. Well, Chris, we're going to take a quick commercial break. We've probably gone over time because we've been ranting and raving. But when we come back, we're going to talk about some results from this past weekend. We're going to talk about some Ask Dave and Ask Chris questions because we got a bunch of those, and we'll go from there. So, guys, stay tuned. We'll be back in 2 minutes.
A legendary name in hardcore supplementation. Iron Mag Labs. 100% original, patent pending, Andro compound. The most effective, hardcore, groundbreaking bodybuilding supplements in the world. Iron Mag Labs. Revolutionizing hardcore supplementation for more than a decade. Visit IronMagLabs.com. IronMagLabs.com.
Hi, I'm Dave Palumbo, and I just had a protein shake made with Quest Nutrition's new salted caramel protein powder. And I can tell you this, it's on a whole new level. It's a total reinvention of the protein shake. The taste is incredible, and its creamy texture and richness make it taste like a real caramel milkshake. It's incredibly low carb, less than 1 gram of sugar, and 22 grams of protein in every serving. No soy, and it's gluten-free. Just add water, ice, a scoop of protein, and shake it up. It's that easy. I actually look forward to drinking this shake. And Quest Nutrition has got a total of 7 different flavors. They come in convenient single-serving packets, so you can mix and match. Check out loveyourproteinpowder.com for more information on Quest protein powders and some delicious shake inspirations.
Welcome back to Heavy Muscle Radio. I'm Dave Palumbo, talking with Chris, the Technician Aceto, and on this lovely April day. And you're telling me there's still snow in your driveway?
Yeah, I have a sloped roof on a Victorian house with a driveway. Anyways, in this corner of my driveway, I'm going to the beach today. But I'm going to take the picture for you, Dave. I still have a 7-foot-long by 2 feet long and 4 inches high piece of snow / ice that this sloping roof, the snow in a snowstorm, just collects in this one spot.
Yeah.
And it just gets higher and higher and higher. This year was like 10 and a half. It was like 10 feet tall, about maybe 7 feet tall. And it's this mound of ice that comes off my roof.
Yeah.
And collects. And it's still there.
Well, it wouldn't last 5 minutes in my fucking driveway with how hot it's been here in Florida.
I'm sure.
Anyway, you know, this past weekend is Easter Sunday, and Susie Blaylock, one of my good clients, I know she listens, big listener to the show, she sent my son some Easter eggs.
Well, that's 3 listeners then. We got Jay, we got yeah, exactly. Susie, and we got Grammy. Good company. And oh, we got Jose too. Yeah.
And Shawn Ray.
Yeah, and C. Blackman. So yeah. We have like 6.
He says, and Ron Harris. So Susie Blaylock sent my son these Easter eggs, and I forgot.
The people who are going to report what we said to like those people.
Yeah, and I forgot, Chris, that on Easter you do the Easter egg thing. So thank you, Susie, for sending that. It was very thoughtful, helping me to keep my child in the holiday spirit. Now, speaking of Shawn Ray, you know, I got a phone call from Shawn Ray, believe it or not, last week. I was surprised because I had him in my caller ID, obviously, because I've talked to him before and we worked together at MD for a number of years. But so I see Shawn Ray come up, and as soon as I answered the phone, he said, welcome, hello. He's like, do you have the recording? Did you hit record as soon as you saw my name on the phone? I said, yep, which I didn't. I would never.
When you told me he called, what's the very first thing I said?
What did you say?
I said, you record it?
Oh, yeah, you did say that. You're right.
I said, you played it on the show.
So I said, Shawn, what do I owe this honor? And he basically wanted to. He was like, I guess he had seen the Flex Wheeler story that I had done on the fact that he threatened me. He goes, now you know what I had to go through with this guy. I'm like, no, I said, you were competing against him. I said, so, I mean, it was different. You were trying to play mind games with him. I wasn't trying to play any mind games with him. He just took offense to what, you know, whatever was said on our TV show. And so he used that as an excuse to call me and basically he was basically trying to say, well, I don't know why you guys, you know, even talk about me and what am I doing so wrong? You know, because I guess he was upset that we were so hard on him with the whole Dallas McCarver thing. I said, Shawn, it was the tone you took with him. It sounded personal to me, whether it was or not. I know you're entitled to your opinion. And as a press guy, I completely love it. I'd love to get you on Iron Debate. I said, because you got a strong opinion, but you certainly have an axe to grind with Chad Nichols. And he's like, I don't want to talk about that. Let's keep it on Dallas. What did I do wrong? I said, well, you know, you could have called the guy up. I said, he did work for the same magazine.
He also did, you know, pom-pom cheerleader on Lee Thompson, but go ahead. When Cedric got DQ'd out of Brazil, that's a fact, but go ahead.
Yeah. Well,
so there's a reason why people don't like him, but
right,
go ahead.
Right, right. Well, because I think he had a vendetta thing against you. That's where the Cedric thing came from. But the bottom line is that I said, I think you let sometimes your personal feelings interfere with, you know, the critiques that you give. Not that they're not accurate, but that I think you're more aggressively, you know, poignant, I should say, with people that, you know, you don't really like or something like that. And he's like, nah, it's not true. Blah, 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 blah. And he's trying to like say, hey, look, I'm just doing the same thing you're doing. I'm just reporting. I said, okay, I give you the right to that. But I said, let me ask you a question. How come you stole Ashkenani away from me at the Arnold? I said, you caused all that whole repercussion, that one action, which I didn't care about. I said, Chris, I mean, Shawn, I said, it didn't matter. You gave me 2 weeks worth of material after that to work with. But you took him away from me without even, I mean, we're friends. You should have said, come up to me and said, hey, Dave, can I interview him? Because you guys aren't ready yet. He's like, I didn't even see you. He didn't see me. He made eye contact with me. We actually locked eyes, and he grabbed Ashkenazi.
You kind of. I was right there.
Yeah.
You kind of fought about it.
Yeah, yeah. Right? We actually almost said words. You know, I was like, what's going on here? And he smirked at me. So in that sense, he was full of shit. You know, but I respect the fact that he called me. And like I said, I don't have a problem with Shawn. I mean, I understand he's just trying to do a job and. It is what it is. But if he, you know, I said, Shawn, look, if you do things that I don't like, of course, it's all about Dave Plummer. If I don't like it, then I'm going to point it out. I said, you know, I might be right or I might be wrong. Let the court of public opinion decide that. But that's what my job is, to call things out. And
I don't believe it.
You can call things out on me if you want.
I don't believe any of it.
You know, so what do you think? There was like an ulterior motive there?
He called you to pump you up against Flex.
Oh, you think that's what it was?
Yeah.
Oh, to get me to not like Flex? I like Flex, so there's no way around it. I don't care, even though Flex...
He wants to get you emotionally charged against Flex and, like, take it into the gutter.
Right.
And otherwise...
He was baiting me, in other words.
You've been not working at muscular undevelopment since 2009?
Yeah.
And he's calling you now about it, about something? I mean, it seems coincidental, or not so coincidental.
Right.
That he wants you to get, like, well, the first thing out of his mouth was, see what I had to deal with.
Yeah.
What's that mean, what I had to deal with? What did you have to deal with, Flex?
I guess.
What does that mean?
I guess Flex, he said that Flex almost, he said he thought at one point Flex was going to actually beat him up, which probably was true.
You made his, you were claiming his body parts were fake.
You made him get his calves x-rayed, exactly.
You know, and you were calling Crime Stoppers and you know.
Oh, my God. The crazy people in our industry, right? But people are mad at me, but I'm the one who's wrong, right, Bob? Bob, but maybe it's you, Dave. You know, well, maybe it is me. Maybe I'm just fucking demented. Maybe I got some problems.
You know what, Dave? I'm open-minded. You know, it could be that you're 100% wrong. I would have to think it through.
Maybe you and me, you and I and Ramada, we might all just be fucking completely off. You know, maybe we should all be in an insane asylum, you know, because it's possible. Possible, because my view of the world may be completely different than the rest of the world. For all I know, I just know what I observe, you know. So, and I report on what I observe. I might be completely wrong, you know. I remember that, you know, one of these philosophy courses I took in college. They said, you know, what if you woke up one day and someone came up to you and said, you know, what color is the sun? And you said, well, it's yellow. And they said, no, you know, it's really blue. And you're like, what do you mean it's really blue? Well, it's blue. And then you start asking, and you go up to all these other people and say, you know, what color is the sun? And everyone says blue. And you're like, and after a while, you might start questioning yourself, am I really seeing the color of the sun? Or maybe, have I been delusional this whole time? It's really blue. I thought it was yellow. Yeah. And so, I mean, that's always possible. Maybe listen, I'm completely off.
I'll give you a different perspective. I asked my kids the other day, you know, what are you doing in terms of what are they doing today in homeschool? And they're studying history. I said, what history? They said, we're studying about World War II. I said, you know what? Maybe we can go on Google after and see if there's any in English history books about World War II from a different perspective. They said, what do you mean? I said, maybe like a Russian perspective.
Right. Or Japanese.
A Japanese perspective to see, and we can find out, you know, because they asked me exactly what caused the war. It was a phone call.
Tell them to call Dorian Yates up. He'll tell them.
No, so I mean, you can. There's different perspectives on things. That was my point with them. Is you know, you're reading a history book, and history book is written by a perspective.
Yeah.
And other people have different perspectives, just like, you know. Have people have different perspectives of what goes on.
It's got to suck if you're German and you're reading like a history book about World War II. Like you really don't want to admit that like your country did something really fucked up. And I know the people who are studying, obviously in school, weren't even born when that happened. But I wonder what the perspective from the German people were on that. Are they like, man, we really screwed up? I mean, or is it like, well, it wasn't that bad, really. You know, everyone's exaggerating. But, you know, yeah, we did lose the war, and, you know, now everything's better. So you're right. There is different perspectives, and it's interesting, you know, to see how people perceive things. And I think that's what makes it hard sometimes to have relationships with people, because you both perceive, or you all perceive things from a different perspective, and the perspective is the perspective we developed growing up. So how we from a childhood to adulthood, that basically shaped our mind and how we see the world. And now when we're exposed to things that happen, we respond differently according to our backgrounds. If we had a bad childhood, maybe, you know, or you didn't your mother was abusive to you, you know, you might respond poorly to when women do things. You might have knee-jerk response or something like that. So I completely agree with that. Speaking of Japanese and World War II, you know, my quote of the week this week is a short one, but it's really appropriate. You know, I always love the Japanese wisdom because it's like very like obvious, but it's deep rooted. And the quote is, "Fall 7 times, stand up 8." And fall 7 times, stand up 8. I mean, basically, we all fall. You fall 10 times, stand up 11 times. You got to keep getting up. And the person who doesn't get up, that's the end of them, basically. That's when you're done. So there's going to be a lot of falls during your life, and you're going to have to just overcome them and just get up and keep going, because it's the person that keeps going that succeeds. The person who doesn't keep going, you know, I guess you could say disappears into oblivion, so to speak.
Yeah, that's part of life, is, you know, getting up. You know, if you don't, you can't get more simple than that. I can't add to what you said.
Yeah. Now, this past weekend, we had a St. Louis Pro Show. Our good friend Jack DeTony held that one. He had a pro figure division where Wendy Fortino wins that event. Then Nadia Wyatt finishes in the second position with Sandra Grajales from Mexico. The number one Mexican figure competitor over there finishes in the third position. And in women's physique, they had Kandria Judd Adams from Georgia. She wins with Brooke Jean Walker in second place. And Joanna Romano, no relation to John Romano from Spain, in third place. Now, Chris, you asked me before the show, why do we report on like the results of all these different divisions? And I said, because we have to pretend that we're at least covering bodybuilding, right? otherwise, it's just the Chris and Dave show talking about all the ramblings and lunacy in our lives, you know.
Oh, that's, you know what, we could report on the show in detail, and people want to know about Shawn Ray phone call, Lex Wheeler, you know.
Exactly. But maybe when Shawn Ray stops getting paid, we'll get him on the show. He'd be a good interview, even though, you know, we might not agree with everything he says. He's definitely a good interview because he's got a very strong opinion on life, that's for sure. All right, let me pull up some Ask Aceto questions because we've got a bunch of them this week. And let's see. Dave, recently listening to your shows, I have noticed plenty of discussions regarding the mindset. Could you and Chris tell me how you as a coach, guru, and ex-bodybuilding athletes, how you dealt with your issues during preparations? Also now, you both are coaches. If how you help your clients if they come to you with issues, I'm asking this question because I wonder if there is a market for working with the mental health and well-being of athletes in your sport. Thanks. Love the show. Sharky. So yeah, Sharky would like to know.
Summarize that question for me, Dave. It's too scientific for me.
People who have mental problems, your clients, when they're mentally, you know, not feeling it, how do you deal with that? How do you, you know, prepare them? And how did you deal with it when you were competing?
I mean, I people have insecurities, right? All good athletes have insecurities to some degree. I'm not that involved with the bodybuilders I work with on that level. I'm not. And so it's hard to answer. I think, you know, people have anxieties, which is very natural. Anxiety is a very natural component to knowing that there is an unknown. There's an unknown result in a bodybuilding contest. There's an unknown result of if your body's going to go where you want it to go. And I just encourage people a lot of times when there's that anxiety is, you know, swirling around in their head, that you're making progress and that, you know, there's still time to get better. You know, I'm not a shrink. Sure. I think to some degree, because I'm older, and I've seen it all to some degree, at least in bodybuilding. Someone I'm working through or with has some level, strong level, I think, of comfort, which gives them, in turn, some type of security, knowing, okay, you know, I'm in good hands.
Right.
So I think that the idea that they could be in decent hands alleviates a lot of those insecurities, so those natural levels of anxiety. Sure. And sometimes I tell people, look, you're either going to be in, you look tremendous, or you're going to look really good. Those are, you know, but if you worry about it and try to look absolutely spectacularly out of this world tremendous, you know what? You're going to overdo everything, including thinking, and you're going to look like average.
And that's very true. My, line I always give to everyone is life happens. Whether you can't put yourself in a bubble, except maybe if you go to Oxygen Gym in Kuwait and eliminate all stress from your life. Things happen, you know, life happens, and you're going to have to, it's how you deal with this adversity and these things that get thrown in your way, these obstacles, that determines if you're a champion or if you're not going to be a champion. The champions find a way to get through the hard times and all the drama in their life, and they wind up emerging, you know, on top. Now, some guys can do that for one show and then they never do it the rest of their career again, because not every prep is going to be stress-free. And I tell people that that's just part of life. And let it run. You know, when you're competing and you're getting ready for a show, you got to just let things roll off you. I mean, I know it sounds callous and uncaring, but the bottom line is that you have to be that way for the show. Because if you're not and you let things emotionally affect you, it's going to affect the way you look and if you cheat or you don't cheat on your diet and all that stuff. So you got to be like a machine. And that's why Dorian was such a great champion. He might not have had the best genetics of anyone up there, but he couldn't be rattled. You can't rattle this guy. And he said it. He goes, no one could have ever worked harder than I could. It's impossible to work harder than I did. And he said he would let things go by and, you know, he just didn't deal with, you know, and after he got, you know, I remember in the interview I watched with him, he said, after I, you know, stopped competing, you know, my life fell apart essentially because I realized that I never was dealing with what the issues were, his marriage and other things, because he would just basically just shunt it off until, because the show was the most important thing. And so you have to be a machine. You have to be, you know, sometimes a little callous when you're getting ready for shows. I know it's not a popular opinion, but that's the bottom line. And I try to tell people that. Get through it and move on. It's not just because you had a bad day doesn't mean you should cheat for a week straight on your diet. You know, if you had one cheat meal, fine, forget it. Move on, back on the diet the next day.
So, good advice.
All right. Dave, I'm glad you finally made it to FIBO. This is our good friend, Derek, who bought you the microphone. Oh, by the way, he sent you a book. I have a book, something about dying. I can't remember, but it's a huge book. I got to send it to you.
Oh, forward. What was he thinking? I'm getting ready to die, or is he getting ready to die?
No, I forget the name of the book. It's something
about
I hope you don't
jinx me.
No, it's not about that. I forget what it's called. I got it in my office. I got to mail it to you this week. Hold on, this is just about the book. He has so many questions. I don't think there's a question here. Hold on. He said this book caused his blood work to change dramatically in all the right directions. So I don't know if your blood work's off, but
I look unhealthy, Derek? I mean, dude, I'm 50. I should look a little unhealthy.
He probably asked me 40 other questions. I probably deleted them, but I thought there was a question there. But all right, see, I got the book for you. I wanted to thank him for sending the book. All right. Question for Chris. Would be interested in your thoughts as well, Dave, but we all know bodybuilding did not begin with the Mr. Olympia, Steve Reeves, Reg Park, Bill Pearl, John Grimmick, to name a few. Who, in your estimation, was the greatest pre-Mr. Olympia bodybuilder of all time? Chris?
Who are the choices there?
He said Steve Reeves, Reg Park, Bill Pearl, John Grimmick. Anyone from before the Olympia was actually, you know, established in 1965.
Who do you say after Steve Reeves? Steve Reeves is
Reg Park.
I mean, he had the Bob Paris physique on. You know,
like, who was the man before Larry Scott came about? Like, who would have won the Olympia?
I mean, I'm 50, dude. How old is this guy? This is the guy giving me the dying book, right?
I wasn't even alive then. I don't even know.
I'm not 80. I can't go all the way back to, like,
Bob Cicherillo probably could do it. He knows old.
Eugene history. Sandow.
Who is the best pre Mr. Olympia?
You know, I don't see many pictures other one. Everyone knows that Steve Reeves picture that he looks just like Bob Paris.
Yeah.
I mean, that's a pretty cool picture. But Reg Park had the muscle. I don't think Grimmick, no, even though my uncle would disagree with me.
Pearl is good. Oh, Pearl is good.
He don't listen to the show, though. He don't have internet. Bill Pearl? Yeah. I would say Steve Reeves.
Okay. I don't even, I can't even make I will not venture my opinion because I don't know, to be honest with you. Because I'd have to have pictures in front of me and study them. And I wasn't around. I mean, it's hard to say who was the best back then. You know, it's an interesting question, though. Because no one's ever really explored it.
There's probably some people were missing. I'm sure people are going to deluge you with, like.
I got to call Jim Mannion and see who he thinks because he was around. All right, Chris, back in the day when you started your coaching services where there were no diet gurus, but times changed since then, how would you stand out from the competition if you started coaching today? And would your approach be different by starting an online coaching service, or would you rely on month-to-month advertising? Thanks and keep up the good work.
Well, if I started today, like as an 18-year-old kid, I'd have no experience. I wouldn't know what the hell I was doing. I'd just
how would you get started?
How would I start? Oh, my – I don't even – I would start – with one person as a guinea pig and see if, you know, what I thought might work works, like high carbs, low carbs, keto, low fat, but I mean, low carbs, but not high fat, a lot of cardio, little cardio. I mean, there's so many variables, so I don't even know where I would start. I wasn't even starting when I thought I was starting. I was just doing something that I thought was fun and cool. And I was, you know, a kid.
Yeah. Yeah.
You know what I mean?
I don't know. I would go online. I think it has to be done through social media now. I think that I when I do the my secret to becoming a diet guru course, which I have, by the way, May 27th, guys, four spots left. Sign up at DavePalumbo.com. I'm telling you, the seats are filling up fast. But when I talk to the kids and the men and women who take the course, I tell them, I said, look, you know, you're going to learn a lot of knowledge here today. You're going to have to, you know, use it to get the experience. But, you know, you have a wonderful, wonderful thing in social media because you can reach so many people so quickly, I said. So if you help a few people for free even, put up their pictures before and after, that's your best-selling tool, you know, to get more clients. I said, but if you don't know what you're talking about, okay, and you try to become a coach and people see that you're full of crap, you're just like kind of using someone else's as templates, you're gonna fail. That's why it's important to educate yourself. And that's why I started doing these Secret to Becoming a Diet Guru courses, because people need to know the science of dieting and putting on muscle mass. And that's really what I teach. And everyone, I think even, I have a lot of experienced guys who took my course. So you would think, oh, these guys must know. And they walked out of there like enlightened, because they're like, wow, I have a much better understanding now of what's going on. So that's our two cents. Last question, Chris. This is a controversial one. You up for it?
Yeah, why not?
All right. It seems like the only person who has brought one of Chris's ex-clients in better condition than he was than he did was Hani Rambat, who brought Jay Cutler to win two Olympias back-to-back. What do you think Hani's secret to bring his athletes in tremendous condition and great fullness at the same time? Can I answer for you and then you can answer?
Yeah.
Well, first of all, I don't agree with that statement, because I think that Jay's best was 01, you know, 02, you know, I mean, so yeah.
Jay was on the show instead.
Before he won the Olympia, because Ronnie was just so good.
Jay was on the Olympia, and you asked him what was his best, and he said that.
01.
I think he said.
Or 02, right?
01, and I think he said followed by that first Arnold that he won when he was 273.
Yeah. So, I mean, I think that Jay was his best with you. I think that he won the Olympia after, because Ronnie was gone. You know, he had already knocked him off, so. It was a lot easier to win the Olympia at that point. So I wouldn't, you know, aside from that one year, I think it was 09, he looked really good, right?
Or tremendous,
I mean, he did come back one time, but I don't think that those were his best. But what would you say? I had to do that to defend you just because I didn't.
No, I would say, you know, 09, he looked incredible. I think that, you know, I always did think that 2000, the first Arnold that he won when he was 273 was just ridiculous. Possibly the Ironman, and people say, well, that's because of the lighting. I'll leave that decision to Jay. But the 01 Olympia, I saw a video, Dave, the other day. It was taken the day after, not, you know, Instagram filtered lighting. It's a video of his, like, his shoulders and his tricep tie-in and his pecs. The pecs were so dry and fibery and ridiculous, and the quads were so round and peeled, and the midsection was so, like, dry that I said, I wish I knew how he looked like that. Like, I, you know, so... But that's that. You know, that's a matter of cutting hairs, I guess.
Yeah. But it's good. We got some good, thoughtful questions. If you guys have more questions, you can send them to huge285@AOL.com to ask me. If you want to ask anything about – ask me any questions, you can send them to aceto@RxMuscle.com. I think we did enough. I think because I got to chime in on some of your questions, so I don't want to overdo this. And I know we got things to do, and we got a late start today. But two more weeks, I'll be out at the Emerald Cup. I think that the when's this Arnold Brazil coming up? Is this this weekend?
It's next week.
Oh, it's next week. It is next week. I thought so.
It's in 7 days or 6 days or whatever.
You know, it's interesting because we really haven't heard a lot of hype and hoopla about this show. If you think about it.
What? What's that mean, Dave?
There has not been a lot of no one's talking about it. Why do you think that is?
I don't. You know, it's
That is a big... Isn't that interesting?
Is it that it's too far away now from the other ones? Remember they used to just be week to week or every 2 weeks they were doing them?
Who's covering it down there?
I don't know. I used to go to that show. I like that show a lot. We went
to that show and had fun times.
Yeah, I've been there many times. We are covering it. I have a photographer down there, and I have my good friend Carlos Godoy. But I'm just saying. But you're right. There's not a lot of people.
You know what? The exciting coverage is when you are there with a mic and camera,
right?
And you can do interviews of the athletes and the people in the high. You know. So I mean, it's next week.
Yeah. Who do you think is going to win? Who's in it? That's a better question. Who's in it? Oh my God, Chris. What are we going to do? I know Juan Morell is in it. I think it was a very smart move on his part. He didn't do the Arnold Australia. He went home after the New Zealand show, which I don't know why he wouldn't. He was there anyway. And now he's doing Brazil. I think it was a smart move on his part. Bought him a few more weeks to get in a little better shape and work on his fullness. I think this could be a show that he can be very dangerous at. And I think that was a smart move on his part, whereas maybe some of the other guys didn't really think it through. But, it's not a big lineup. It wasn't a big lineup last year. I don't understand why they're having trouble fielding the show other than the fact that it might not be – it's just not on the right day, you know?
I don't know.
No hypothesis?
I
don't know.
I can't even get past the fact that there's no hype running into the show, that we don't know about the show. I blame you because if you didn't cover it, I mean, have you done any coverage on it?
No, because I don't really even have a competitor list, you know, to really talk about. I mean, I'd like to. I know they have the pro strongman down there. Brian Shaw is going to be in that. They have pro figure fitness. That's like usually Regina Da Silva's show. They have a model search. They got the bodybuilding pro show. I'm pretty sure Victor Martinez is in it.
Well then, Victor and it'll be a New York Pro rematch. Victor and I mean, there's two other.
They have Victor on the poster, so I'm. That's the only reason I'm saying that. I could be wrong. I don't know why I can't find the competitor list. I'd like to talk about who's in the show. Let me see if I could find it. They have this new thing. Well, it's not a new thing now anymore, but they don't put these competitor lists out till the Monday before the show. I don't know why they don't do this. All right, let's see what they got here. They have lists for every other year, but I don't see 2017. I'm telling you, I just don't understand why we just have not seen the type of publicity that we've seen in the past for it. It's strange, very odd, very odd. Oh, here it is. Oh, did you know your boy Guy Cisternino's doing it? You must know
that.
Yeah,
I know he's doing it. That's the only reason.
How could you not know his name then?
No, that's the only reason I know it's in 7 days.
Guy doing another open show too. I think this might be a record, right? No other 212 guy has done two open shows.
No, he's just give me a bodybuilding show, I'll go to it.
Johnny Jackson is in the show. Thomas Kaspar from Czech Republic. Michael Lockett, another good guy. Obviously can be dangerous. Juan Diesel Morel. Lucas Osladil from Czech Republic also. Derek Upshaw from the United States. Actually from your area. He's from Boston, your area there. And Earl Abrams from South Africa. So it's not a very deep lineup. I mean, of those people, Juan is the biggest name. Michael Lockett is probably the most consistent conditioning-wise. Lucas Osladil has shocked us with a few wins over the last couple of years. And Guy is probably got a very good chance of cracking that top three or four, you know, I would say. Johnny Jackson, obviously, we have to consider him, too. I didn't really add him into the list. But, he's a guy who could win the show as well, you know. So it's not a deep lineup in terms of talent pool, but and numbers, but you know it'll probably be a competitive show because everyone kind of can compete with each other. They all have their own gifts. Obviously, if Juan comes in at his best, I don't think anyone beats him. But we haven't seen Juan his best this year yet.
Yeah. So I mean, he's potentially he could win. Juan Morel could win it. I would have to go with.
I mean, he's the biggest name in there. I mean, the highest placing name in there.
You know, when he's big, and when he's you know, it's the, you know, he's like the, let me see.
Can you imagine if Guy won the show?
He's like the, what's the, he's like a Snapchat stock. Yeah. One day it's up, one day it's down. That's,
can you,
one.
But can
one day
you
he's
imagine,
full, one day he's flat.
Can you imagine if Guy Sestanino won the show? I know Guy listens to the show.
My interview would beat the one you did with.
Cedric won, right?
No. The interview was the interview of the guy who won the North America that year. Turned into Muhammad Ali.
Oh, Shawn Allen.
Shawn Allen.
If Guy won the Arnold Brazil, it would be the greatest interview of all time. I mean, there would be nothing to top it. He should just, if he does, you should, Guy, if you're listening to the show, which you probably do, just retire after that if you win the show. Just say, you know what, that's it. They can't do any better than this. And I the only 212 guy to win an open show and... maybe go to the Mr. Olympia just to say you did it. But I'd love to see that. I'm like a Guy Cicherillo fan because I love how intense he is and how hard
he works.
You
want to get the quotes. You want to get the quotes after you. You want to get the, you know, the interview.
But we'll see. Look, it's an Arnold title. It's a good title. You know, obviously they'll be judging the posing round in this show. It'll be interesting to see who wins this one because. I don't know. It's just it's an interesting lineup. That's the best I can say. And that's on that little note, I'm glad I remembered about the Arnold Brazil since it is an important show. We're going to call it quits. We're at the end of another episode of the Heavy Muscle Radio Show. Until next week, remember, with Heavy Muscle Radio,
the truth hurts.